Exciting to be here. So before I start, I really just want to get a sense, just so I have a sense of really what to talk about. How many of y'all are somewhat familiar with the Khan Academy, you or your children, or, oh, good, all right, oh, this is preaching to the choir, this will be easy. Actually, maybe the other way, how many have not heard of the Khan Academy? Oh, that's good, so this will be productive, too. That's a very, very good use of time. So what we'll see, and I'll go into the whole narrative of how Khan Academy started somewhat accidentally and where it's going, but to a large degree, it started off with me making videos, and that's what a lot of people perceive Khan Academy to be right now, and we'll see that it's much more beyond that. But to start off, just so that everyone is on the same page, I want to show a little montage of these videos, and then we'll talk a little bit about how I ended up making them and where this is all going.
So the hypotenuse is now going to be 5. This animal's fossils are only found in this area of South America, a nice clean band here, and this part of Africa. We could integrate over the surface, and the notation usually is a capital sigma. National Assembly, they create the Committee of Public Safety, which sounds like a very nice committee. Notice this is an aldehyde, and it's an alcohol. Start differentiating into effector and memory cells. A galaxy, hey, there's another galaxy. Oh look, there's another galaxy. And for dollars, is there 30 million? Plus the $20 million from the American manufacturer. If this does not blow your mind, then you have no emotion.
And what's exciting about being here is y'all are one of the few audiences that actually have your mind blown by that equation. So it's exciting to be here. So just to give you a snapshot of where we are now, and as I said, it's a lot more than just the videos. This is kind of a relatively current assessment of kind of the scale at which we're operating. 100, actually I think it's like 124 million or 25 million lessons delivered to date. That's slightly old, it's like from a few weeks ago. It's 400 million exercises have been done on the Khan Academy, and we'll talk about what the exercises are. Y'all have just seen the videos. And then 52 million page views a month, and about 4.7 million students per month are using it right now, and those numbers are growing fivefold every year. And you know, out here in the Valley, we get all used to, you know, million here, million there, but it really is important to kind of realize these are large numbers, especially in the context of education, and that's why, you know, not picking on Harvard, they're just the oldest university in North America, so, you know, the number of unique students we had last month was 8 times the total number of students that have ever attended Harvard since 1636. So it's a reasonably large number. What I want to do before going into where Khan Academy is now and where it's going, and you know, it's kind of an adventure to figure out where it's all going, is try to talk about how it started, because it's been a fairly organic and serendipitous process. In 2000, my background is originally in computer science, and then I went back to business school, and I somehow ended up at a hedge fund in Boston in 2004. And I had just gotten married, and I had some family visiting me from New Orleans. They attended my wedding in New Jersey, and then they wanted to come up to Boston just to kind of see the sights. That's where I worked at the time. And it was my aunt, Nazrat Auntie, her husband, Azad Mamu, and her children, Nadia, Arman, and Ali. And Nadia was a 12-year-old. She was about to start 7th grade. This was in late summer of 2004. And we were in Boston, it was actually 4th of July weekend. I remember waiting for the fireworks over the Charles River, and you know, just to kill time, I was giving the family brain teasers, you know, just that's how I roll. I remember the rest of the family was like, hey, we're not here to think, we're on vacation, but Nadia, 12-year-old Nadia, was like, oh, let me figure it out. And I remember her, you know, kind of trying to draw things out on the sand, and these were really good brain teasers, the type of things that you would see in a job interview or whatever. And this was a 12-year-old, and she was really engaged in them, and I was very, very, very impressed. And I was telling her, I was like, you know, Nadia, you know, we're here in Boston, you should tour some of the universities, you know, maybe you should go into computer science, you have this logical mind, let's go look at MIT, I think this is right for you, and, you know, then you could go and become a hedge fund analyst and all the rest. And the highest calling in life. And the next morning, before Nadia had woken up, her mother, Nazrat Auntie, was, you know, we were just having breakfast, and she told me, she's like, you know, Sal, this has been a great trip, thanks for showing us all around, and you're like an older brother to Nadia, Arman, and Ali, and they really look up to you, and I really appreciate that you've been kind of cheerleading Nadia and improving her self-esteem, but I just wanted to let you know that she's actually having trouble with math. And I immediately told Nadia, told Nusrat Nadia, I said, that's hard to believe, that the 12-year-old who was doing those problems yesterday, those are far more complex and logical problems than anything that you would ever have to see in sixth or seventh grade math. And on top of that, you know, we shared a certain amount of DNA. And she's like, no, you know, you can talk to her about it, but she apparently took an assessment and didn't do so well on it, and she's being tracked into the slower track. And I was particularly worried about that because seventh grade really is kind of that inflection point in a lot of people's academic careers where the system really does start tracking students and really does say these students are meant to go become doctors, lawyers, and engineers. These students are going to be white-collar workers but not doctor or lawyers and engineers. And these students are going to be blue-collar workers and they're never going to take calculus or have a chance of doing something in science or engineering. And so when Nadia woke up and she comes in, I was like, you know, look, your mom's been telling me this stuff. I find it hard to believe what's going on. And Nadia says, well, there was an exam at the end of last year that was a placement exam, and she just bombed units. She couldn't figure out units, you know, kilograms to milligrams, gallons to ounces, whatever else. And I immediately told her, I was like, look, Nadia, and this isn't just a pep talk, I'm genuinely saying this. You know, if I thought that you really weren't capable, I would just keep my mouth shut. But what you were doing last night is far deeper than this. And I'm 100% convinced that this was kind of a mistake or you're just kind of psyching yourself out. And I could tell she was appreciative of it, but she kind of was inside of her mind rolling her eyes like, okay, this is just a pep talk, but no, I really can't process math and especially this unit conversion stuff. And I kind of sensed that. So I said, Nadia, here's the deal. When you go back to New Orleans, and we're going to go back in a couple of days, and that's where I grew up as well. When you go back to New Orleans, every day after school, if you're up for it, because there's going to be more work for you, it's also going to be more work for me, and after work for me, let's get on the phone, and I want to tutor you. And if we can figure out something on the internet where we can share a whiteboard and we can work out problems together, we'll use that. And, you know, I think she was skeptical, but she liked the fact that her older cousin was willing to invest in her. So she said, sure. So she went back, and we started this thing. And, you know, the first month was fairly painful. I would ask her a question, you know, 1 kilometer is how many meters? And just, you know, pause. It was just this very awkward pause. And I was like, what does kilo mean? And she would go, 1,000. And I was like, okay, so 1 kilometer is, and it was just like her brain was completely shut off. I could talk her, if we were not talking about math, or if she didn't know she was talking about math, her brain was engaged and she could process, but here it was just completely shut off. And so I finally, and you know, when she did answer, she would go, 1,000? And I would say, you know, Nadia, are you sure? And it was just this it was struggling, and as frustrating as it was for me, it was probably even more frustrating for her. You know, here's her cousin trying to invest time, he's probably getting frustrated, she's getting even more and more frustrated. And then after about a month, I just said, look, Nadia, let's just cut to the chase. If you don't understand something, just let me know. I'm not going to judge you. I'm assuming you're smart. I know you're smart. And if you do know the answer, don't answer it as a question. Just say it affirmatively. And so then she started to, I think she was almost angry at that point and frustrated at that point as well. But then we started to make progress. You know, I asked a question. She says, I don't know that. I don't understand that. And I would explain it. Or if she knew the answer, she'd say 1,000. And something very interesting happened. After about 2 weeks, all of a sudden, one day, Nadia was like, I get it. And it wasn't like a happy I get it. It was actually an angry I get it. Because she was like, this simple thing that now had clicked in her brain, this is what was derailing her math career. This is what was kind of sapping all of the confidence from her. And as soon as she got over that, she then started racing ahead and you know, to cut a long story short, by the ninth grade, this was seventh grade, by ninth grade, she was taking calculus at University of New Orleans and ended up essentially tapping out most of their math classes before high school. So once again, student, and this is a theme that we'll see throughout this talk, someone who thought that they were below average ends up becoming fairly exemplary. I started working with her brothers. Then after that, I was kind of, you know, hooked on this teaching bug. I felt I could help my family members. Then, you know, word got around in the family, and you fast forward to about 2006. So this is about 2 years from that date, and I was tutoring after work about 20 family members, all over the country. And while I was doing that, I actually, you know, I had this computer science background that I wasn't fully using in my hedge fund job. So I started writing little JavaScript thing so that I could generate problems for my cousins. Before, you know, there's all these resources on the web, but they were very fragmented. So I was like, okay, here's something to practice basic linear equations. Here's something to practice exponents, whatever else. And then on our tutoring sessions, I would ask them, you know, how did that go? How many did you get right or wrong? And then I wouldn't believe them. So then I put a database behind the whole thing. And That was actually interesting. It's actually a common theme, is that the data in some ways is more powerful than the content, because then I could immediately, before our tutoring sessions, I would see a log of what problems they did, how long it took them, what hints they did, and what actually one of the most valuable things is seeing when they did the problems. I mean, my 8-year-old cousin Ali at the time, he was doing the problems at 3 a.m. And I was like, Nazrathan, do you know that your son is awake? And, well, anyway, it was a... So fast forward to 2006, I'd run all the software, and I was kind of proud of it. It was a little bit of a hobby for me. And I was having, and by this time, the fund I worked for, my boss's wife became a professor at Stanford Law School, so we moved the fund out. It was a very small fund to Menlo Park. And I was having dinner at a friend's house in San Mateo. His name's Zulfikar Ramzan, and actually it's very relevant. His thesis advisor at MIT was Ron Rivest, so it all comes circles back. But I was showing him all of this stuff that I was doing and telling him about how I was working with my cousins. And I said, you know, but the one frustration I'm starting to have is I'm having trouble scaling. You know, even now that I'm getting to 20 students, I'm not getting that same interaction that I had with Nadia. I'm having trouble, even if I try to do a conference call with 4 or 5 students, it's not the same thing. I'm having trouble diagnosing what's happening with students. Sometimes I feel like some of my cousins or family members, they aren't understanding something, but they're embarrassed to ask it because maybe it was something that they should have learned a few weeks ago, or maybe it was something that we covered a few days ago and they maybe weren't paying attention when I covered it the first time. And so I sometimes I would cover one thing and then a few weeks later, another cousin wants to cover the same thing and it's very repetitive for me. And Zuli's feedback to me is, well, you know, why don't you make some of your lectures, especially on a lot of the core concepts, and why don't you put them up on YouTube? And, you know, I was immediately dismissive. I said, no. YouTube is for cats playing piano. not for serious mathematics. But I was like, that's a good, you know, interesting idea. And I went home that weekend and kind of got over the idea that it wasn't my idea and gave it a shot. And a bunch of very, very interesting things started to happen after. You know, I did those first videos. And, you know, when I made those videos, I literally didn't have a video camera. I said, look, this is just going to be for my cousins. I don't care. Maybe I'll just do screen capture, because that worked for Nadia. It was just, we were using Yahoo Doodle at the time, where we would write on it, she would see what I write, and she would just hear my voice. I would just hear her voice. So I was like, maybe I can find some good screen capture software, get a cheap USB headset, and I could start recording these things. And that's what I did. And I put it out on YouTube. I remember that first day, do you want to make this public or private? I said, well, I'll make it public. If someone else watches it, that's great too. And I told my cousins, hey, you know, watch these, tell me what you think. And their very first feedback was interesting. They told me that they preferred me on YouTube than in person. I still haven't clarified whether that's across all subject matters in a general statement, but when I inquired more and asked them why, and when I actually just thought about it from their point of view, it actually made a ton of sense. Now they could review something that they maybe should have learned 2 or 3 years ago without feeling embarrassed. They could review something that we actually might have covered live without feeling embarrassed. They could engage in the content when they were actually ready to engage in the content. Not, you know, before when we do our tutoring session, we continue to do our tutoring sessions, but our tutoring sessions were at a set date every day, you know, 5 p.m. Eastern time, 4 p.m. Central. Some days I wasn't fully there. I had a tough day at work. I was tired. Some days I'm sure they weren't there. You know, maybe the boy that Nadia was hoping would ask her to the prom, ask somebody else, or they have other homework or whatever else. They just weren't ready to be engaged. But now they could engage with the content when they were ready for the content. They could pause. They can repeat all the rest. And so I was pretty excited. I viewed that as positive feedback. And so I kind of kept making videos. And then, you know, kind of like these kind of YouTube internet stories happen, I started noticing that, you know, hey, I told like 4 cousins to watch that video, and like 20 people have watched that, people who are not my cousins. And then comments started to roll in on YouTube. And I don't know how much time many of y'all have spent on YouTube, but most of the comments are not so positive. nor G-rated. But here, all of a sudden, these comments, some were just thank you. Or, I mean, they were 99% positive. They were thank you. They were like, this really helped. Or I have an exam tomorrow, and this is really what took me over the top. And then they started to get pretty interesting. I started to get comments, and then through YouTube, I started to get messages. I'm a parent of a child with dyslexia and this kind of handwritten style you do, this conversational style, this, you know, not having to focus on a face and they can focus on the content and use all these colors. This is what's really working for them. Parents of gifted students, parents of or gifted students themselves, and parents of students with learning disabilities or students with learning disabilities themselves actually emailing me and saying this is what's working for them. This is what's allowing them to re-engage in the content. People who are retiring from the military going back to college saying this is what's allowing them to revisit math that there's no other way for them to re-engage with. I got, you know, in those early days, this is like now 2007, early, late 2007, I got letters, you know, one distinctly, and there were many along this flavor, you know, of a family saying, me and my entire family pray for you every night for making these videos. And you know, you have to remember, I was working at a hedge fund. In that context, I think it was only the investors that might have done some form of prayer or something. So I just kept going and going and going. It was exciting for me. And you know, a bunch of non-intuitive things started to dawn on me. One was, you know, when I started, I was like, oh, I'm just going to do a bunch of videos, but there's no way I could tackle all of math, even all of algebra. You know, you look at those textbooks, they're like this big thing. You look at all the textbooks that you go K through 12 and then calculus and on, and you're like, oh, I'm not going to be able to cover all of that stuff. That would be a gargantuan task. But after like about, I don't know, about 100 videos in algebra, I was like, you know, that's a pretty good scaffold of algebra. And it started to dawn on me because, you know, all my MBA friends were saying, oh, focus on the platform, content will never scale. But I was like, no, but this content, contrary to what a textbook publisher will tell you, does scale. This content never does go old. You don't have to have a new textbook every 3 years. If, you know, as I joke, if Newton or Leibniz had done videos on YouTube, I wouldn't have to. And so I just kept going. It started to become kind of like a Forrest Gump type, you know, run across the country, see how much I could do. Started doing algebra, started doing calculus, started doing physics and economics and finance. And actually, there's some interesting things. Right around 2008, as you can imagine, I was working in finance and all hell broke loose, and you know, we parked our entire fund in cash because we're like, we don't understand what's going on. And I was just reading the Federal Reserve Act like every day. It was like becoming a ritual for me. And I was like, even the people on TV don't understand what's going on. And so then I started to just make videos explaining liquidity versus insolvency and what a credit default swap is and what a derivative is. And soon after, I got calls, and I won't say which news networks. I got a call from a news network, actually two, saying that their reporters were watching these videos before reporting on the credit crisis, which is actually a somewhat heartening and scary story. There's a video on mortgage-backed securities, which is actually one of the most popular videos on all of Khan Academy. And I got a letter from someone, once again, I won't say who and from what bank, saying, I've been working in mortgage-backed securities for the past 5 years, and I finally understand what I'm doing. Let's see. So it's better late than never, I guess, So I kept going, and then you fast forward to 2009. The viewership on the site kept growing and growing and growing, mainly through word of mouth. We started getting a little bit of press and all of that. And then by the fall of 2009, I frankly just had trouble focusing on my day job. And so, you know, we looked at our savings, and I set up Khan Academy as a 501c3 not-for-profit. And I kind of said, well, someone's got to realize that there's an infinite social return on an investment here. That, you know, I'm making these videos, so even the videos, these can teach people forever. And, you know, especially if we translated or if we had exercises on top of it, but just the videos alone in English can reach millions upon millions of students. And even if, God forbid, I got hit by a bus, they could keep teaching. And so for essentially to just let me do it, you could reach an unlimited number of students for all of time. And so my thinking, very, kind of naively, because I had never worked in a not-for-profit space, I've never raised money for a not-for-profit, I said, well, what if I quit my job, do this full-time? Someone's got to realize that this is a high social return on investment, that it's kind of an infinite social return on investment, and a very small investment at that. And so I quit my job to do Khan Academy full-time, this not-for-profit thing. And you know, the deal with my wife is I would do it for a year and see what happens. And the site traffic was growing so much, it just felt like it was the right time. And I think like a lot of entrepreneurial stories, and actually another reason why I quit my job is there was one foundation that seemed really interested in funding. And I think like a lot of entrepreneurial stories, it was kind of like, well, this is a really good idea, and we see it, but how come no one else has given you any money? How come, if it's so obvious, how come you're essentially working from your closet, which is where I was working from? And so literally a week after I quit my job, they decided to not fund Khan Academy. And so it was kind of, we were living off of our savings, You fast forward about 9 months. We're now getting to May of 2009. This is all still not too far long ago. I started getting nervous. You know, the fish weren't biting in terms of funding us. I even thought about, you know, I started updating my resume, although I don't know if the hedge fund world will take me back after doing something so altruistic. And it's clearly a character flaw. No, there are some very good people in the field, so I don't want to. So, you know, I was getting nervous, frankly. And then May of 2010, I'd put a little PayPal link on the website. People asked, I mean, college students, you know, poor college students were saying, I want to give you $5, $10 just because it helped me. And they were coming in, and it was really heartening, but that wasn't, you know, that wasn't paying the bills. But then all of a sudden, on PayPal, a $10,000 donation came in. And I was like, wow. And I immediately, I said, who is this? Her name was Andor. The last name rang a bell. But I was like, yeah, maybe it's a common name. And I emailed her back, and I was like, well, you know, thank you so much. This is the largest donation we've ever gotten. If this was a physical school, you would now have a building named after you. And now I've learned, based on, you know, conversations at Stanford and other places, that's actually quite cheap for a building. So there's a. And you know, I just thank you. And Ann immediately emailed back. I mean, I think it was literally within minutes, and says, well, you know, that's unbelievable. We should talk. And so we literally, I think the next week after that, we met at an Indian buffet off of University Ave in Palo Alto. And Ann kind of said, oh, well, you know, what are you hoping to do and all the rest? And I was like, well, I want to keep making videos. I can, you know, cover calculus, economics, physics, linear algebra, differential equations. I want to do everything. You know, the mission of this, the mission statement of the organization is a free world-class education for anyone, anywhere. And to do that fully, it won't just be videos. We'll translate the videos, but on top of that, we'll build a whole platform, essentially boning up what I had done for my cousins. So students can get exercises. It'll be adaptive. It'll advance them as they need to. It'll give them hints when they get stuck. The videos will be there. All the data is being logged so that we can iterate and be smart about what content is good, what's not, how do we engage students more? And you know, she kind of nodded. She said, well, no, this makes a lot of sense. How are you supporting yourself when you're doing this? And, you know, I, as proudly as possible, said, well, I'm not. And she kind of nodded, and so, you know, very nice. And I went back home, drove back home. And right when I was getting into the driveway, I got a text message from Ann. And she said, well, you know, you should be supporting yourself, so I've just wired you $100,000. And you know, I almost crashed it. So that was a good day. That was a good day. And then it got crazier, and it kind of started. I don't know if it started. A lot of these things kind of happened somewhat independently. Right around that same time, this was a few weeks later, the folks at Google brought me in. You know, I say there's two major institutions in Mountain View, Google and the Khan Academy. But the it gets more laughs here than at Google. But they brought me in, and they said, well, you know, we love what you're doing. And this was the first I had heard of this. They said, a lot of our team, especially the children, use your stuff. But even some of our team use some of your more advanced calculus, differential equations, linear algebra stuff. We're curious about what you're doing. I gave that same kind of presentation that I had given to Ann, what I hoped to be doing. They just kind of nodded. Then they brought me in a couple of weeks later, and then they said, literally point blank, when I walked into the room, you know, all of these Google people, and they said, well, what would you do with $2 million? And you know, I said, is this an open question? You know, I could get some, you know, new shoes or something. And it was about education. And I said, well, I would do exactly what I presented and possibly even translate the content and all the rest. And they kind of nodded. And I didn't know what to make of it. By this point, I had presented to so many foundations that I'd become somewhat cynical, somewhat jaded. So you know, that happened. And then in July of 2010 now, I was running this little camp in Portola Valley. And I'd been spending so much time tutoring people virtually, asynchronously, on the web, that I thought it would be fun. This was actually the second year I did it with another fellow. And I said, well, it would be fun to actually be kind of a real teacher for real kids and see, run fun games and fun experiments and that type of thing. So it was a little thing that we called the mental boot camp in Portola Valley. There was 20 kids. I was essentially their teacher with this other guy, Aragon. And we were doing this game where six of the kids were playing a game of Risk, and then the other 20 kids were trading securities based on the outcome of the game of Risk. And it's a very good game. Maybe for next year's conference, it would be very. But while that was happening, all of a sudden I got a text message from Ann. And you know, text messages from Ann now I pay attention to. And this one was even crazier than the last one. It was all. It was a bunch of text messages. It's hard to figure out which one came first and all the rest. But it said, "At Aspen Ideas Festival, in the main tent, Bill Gates is on stage talking about you for the last X minutes. Talk saying he uses it, his kids use it, and all the rest." And I'm just staring here. I immediately booted the closest seventh grader off of a computer, and I started saying, and like people were tweeting about it. There was even a couple of even like mini blog posts people were writing about. I was like, this is real. This is actually happening. And so, I mean, you can imagine my life for the next few days, because this happened, I verified it. The video footage wasn't out yet, but I was still working from a closet. And I was just, I went to bed that night just kind of saying, what do I do now? Do I call him? Is Bill listed? What is the protocol, the process? And so actually the next few weeks were somewhat unusual, awkward, surreal. I mean, there was kind of two realities going on here. And then 2 weeks into it, I get a phone call. Apparently, Bill was able to find my number. And I got a call from Larry Cohen, who's Bill Gates' chief of staff. And he says, oh, you might have heard, Bill's a fan. And I'm like shaking the whole, yeah, I heard that. He would like to meet you. He would like to fly you up to Seattle, figure out how he can support the Khan Academy. I was like, oh, yeah, that sounds good. And he's like, if you're free to do this. And I was looking at my calendar at the moment for the next month, and it was completely blank. And I said, yeah, maybe like Wednesday, 2:45. I could just fly in, and then, right between a bath and cutting my nails, I can fit Bill Gates in. And so I go up to Seattle, and I meet with Bill. I call him Bill now. And I actually did not know what to call him the first time. And when he walked in, I was like, nice to meet you. And I was like, do I call him Mr. President of Bill Gates, Microsoft Universe, whatever? But we talked about it, and he decided to support us. And it was funny because when he nodded, there were like five people on the other side of the room who like wrote it down. Then I was like, yeah, you got it. And so flew back. When I flew back, I immediately started calling some of the smartest people I know. It's like, hey, I think Bill Gates is going to support us. Do you want to join? And I started seeing if I could attract other people, because now we would have resources. And right at about the same time, it was literally within a few weeks, Google announced that they had this 10 to the 100th project where they were going to fund five projects that could change the world. And they were going to give $2 million to each of them. And they also announced that Khan Academy was one of these five projects. So all of a sudden, in a matter of like literally 4 months, it went from being a project in the closet to kind of getting validation from Andor, Bill Gates, and Google. And we were, we started looking for office space and all the rest. And the crazy thing that happened is, the Khan Academy site, obviously we were now going to be able to have engineering talent onto it. We were going to build that whole platform and all the rest. But right at about that same time, we got some press. There was a Fortune article about the whole Bill Gates thing and all of that. Los Altos School District, right here, they said, hey, we'd love to chat with you about what you're up to. And so myself and Shantanu, who was, he was a consultant at McKinsey, and I convinced him to kind of be our president and COO at Khan Academy, we went over to the Los Altos. We met with the school board, and they said, well, what would you do if you could do anything with a classroom? And we said, well, we would have every student working at their own pace. We would have, the teacher wouldn't be giving lectures anymore. They would be sitting alongside students. We would optimize not the student to teacher ratio, we would optimize the student to valuable time with the teacher ratio. So that every interaction with the teacher, every interaction in the classroom is a human interaction. And you don't have any of this kind of tracking of students in an unnatural way. And so they kind of nodded and they said, well, this is true differentiation. This is kind of the ideal in education, but this is very radical, not giving lectures, having every student go at their own pace, but we'll think about it. It's an interesting idea. And so we didn't think they would take it that seriously. But literally 2 days later, we got an email from them. It's like, can we start in 2 weeks? Literally after Thanksgiving. This is a school district wanting to do a pilot with real kids in a real classroom. And we were essentially we were almost like a 3.5 person organization at this time. So it was a little bit, but we said, sure, let's do it. And so we started up, Los Altos started a pilot. And so what I want to show you is, well, one, I'll show you some of the stuff that generally we started working on. And actually, some of these are, a lot of this stuff has been modernized even since when these slides were made, but they give you the feel of things. So this right here, this just gives you a sense of what's on the site. And the site has been updated since then. But there's on the order of about 3,000 videos. Right now, I've made about 3,000 of them. We actually have more than 3,000 because we've started to have a few other people make videos of a certain, we have some art historians starting to make art history videos, and we have a couple of other people making videos of a slightly different flavor. But it gives you a sense of the scope of the videos. There's everything there from macroeconomics to vector calculus to American history to the credit crisis. This right here is the knowledge map. And you know, when I talked before about making that software for my cousins, once I made a bunch of these concepts that would quiz you on fractions or multiplying decimals, I started getting tired of telling my cousins, OK, now let me assign this to you or that to you. So I said, well, let me just define some level of mastery. And once a student masters one concept, it'll just progress them to the next. So on this knowledge map, we're in the process of rethinking this a little bit, so it becomes a little bit more efficient, a little bit more adaptive. But the general idea from the get-go was you started basic ideas, and once you show mastery in them, then you move on to more advanced ideas. So you build a really, really strong foundation as you progress, and you just go at your own pace. And it's a completely obvious thing. So, and I'll show you what each of those nodes look like, what each of those exercises look like. It's a kind of obvious thing. It's how video games work. It's how music class would work. It's how karate class would work. You only proceed to yellow belt once you pass the white belt exam. You only proceed to green belt once you pass the yellow belt exam. So it's the same very natural way. It's actually how you would learn most things. But it's worth emphasizing that it's very different than the way we learned when we were in school. In a traditional academic model, what is fixed is how long you have to learn something and when you get to learn it. And what is variable is how well you actually learn it. So we have 2 weeks on systems of equations. Some of us get A's, some of us gets B's, some of us get C's. Even though C, the assessment is telling you that you did not understand systems of equations fully, we are then moving on to a more advanced concept and somehow expecting students to master the next concept. What we're saying is no. Let's make fixed the level of mastery, that everyone masters a concept. And what's variable is how long you have to learn something and when you actually get to learn it. And you know, the analogy for the traditional system is imagine you're building a house, you build a foundation, you get the inspector to show up, the inspector says, oh, this is an 80% foundation. It's 80% sound, structurally sound. You're like, great, that's a C, let's build the first floor. And then the first floor, same thing, great, second floor, third floor. And then when the fourth floor collapses, you blame the contractor who built that fourth floor, or you blame the teacher, or whoever it is. But the whole problem is that the whole time the student is getting these little Swiss cheese gaps in their knowledge, and by the time you're in calculus or trigonometry, it's almost impossible to even realize that the real problem is with that student doesn't understand what happens when you take something to the zeroth power, or what a logarithm really is. And so we're saying, no, let's just make a really strong foundation and move from there. This is just what one of those exercises look like. This is one of the more rote ones. The videos are very conceptual. There are some worked examples, but they really try to focus on understanding the general idea. This is one of the more rote exercises. And if you go to Khan Academy now, you'll actually find more ones that are much more conceptual exercises, where they're manipulatives, where students are trying to manipulate things so they really understand the underlying idea behind the question. And as you see, if you don't know how to do something, you can click a hint, and it'll show you the steps and things like that. This is just another one. This goes more advanced. And actually, now it's going well into calculus. We're adding content every day. I would say in the next 6 months, we're going to cover most of calculus, and we're going to start going into linear algebra, differential equations, physics, chemistry, biology. The videos already cover all of that and go into a lot more depth. This is a dashboard from Los Altos, one of those fifth grade classrooms. And every row here is one of the students. I blocked their names out for privacy. Every column here is one of those concepts. And the paradigm is green means the student's already proficient in that. Blue means they're working on it, but no need to worry. And red means they're stuck. And so the teacher literally walks around with this dashboard in real time. It updates in real time. And they say, hey, that student is stuck. Why don't I go do a very focused one-on-one intervention with that student? Or even better, why don't I get one of those other students who are already proficient in that concept? Why don't I have them be my TAs for that topic and have them tutor the students? And that's actually been happening even in fourth and fifth grade classrooms. And it's pretty neat to see it. This is some of the data that the teachers have access to. We're kind of trying to arm the teachers with the same data that probably all of y'all have in your professions that I had when I was working in finance or before when I worked in Silicon Valley before business school. This is just other charts and graphs. Tells teachers what the student's been focused on, what they're not focused on, what problems they've been up to. You can even click on any of those problems. The height there tells you how long the student took. Red is wrong, blue is right. We're trying to create a full narrative for the teacher and the student so they can really diagnose, and the parent. You can go sign up your kids for this tomorrow. It's all free. You'd have access to the exact same dashboards and analytics that the teachers in Los Altos have. And what we're trying to give them as much data as possible on what's actually going on in students' minds. This is a chart that the teachers use to keep track of all the students. There's multiple views here. The horizontal axis is days on the site, so it's time. Vertical axis is modules completed, so it's a rough count of progress. So each line is a different student. And what's neat about this, it's a neat way to look at how everyone's progressing, is it tells a really interesting narrative that's in line with what happened with Nadia. We're seeing over and over again that, yes, there's some students who race ahead, some students who start a little slow. But if you let every student work at their own pace and build their foundation on more basic concepts, even if you're in algebra class, it's okay if they're working on decimals, logarithms, whatever else. Some of those students that you thought were below average 2 months ago end up becoming the best student in the class. And that's one example of that. And we're seeing that over and over again, different demographics, different classrooms. We're doing it in East Palo Alto now. We're doing it in charter schools, public schools, private schools. We're seeing it over and over again. Once you let students work at their own pace and build those foundations, it is hard to tell who is going to be the gifted student or who is going to be the advanced student. It could literally be anybody. To give an idea of kind of the energy level in these rooms, and because a lot of people, when they think about computer-based learning, they imagine kind of this Borg reality, the Vulcans, kids just doing questions all day. But what we want to, and you should visit some of these classrooms, there are kids helping each other, the teacher's there, it's interactive, it's more human than a traditional classroom, and there's a super high energy level, and that's why I want to show this video right here to just capture some of the energy level.
From Mountain View, California, NBC's Kristen Welker has our story tonight.
What makes fifth graders cheer? Would you believe math?
Yes. I'm starting to really like math now.
These kids are learning with the help of Khan Academy, an online school.
You got it right. Good job.
Videos that are interactive and fun, explaining difficult concepts in a conversational way.
And there was actually a very fun story that came out of when that reporter visited that classroom. She saw a little fifth grader doing trigonometry, legitimately basic trigonometry, but she understood sine, cosine, tangent, ratios of the sides of triangles. She was doing it, and she was understanding it, graphs of trig functions. And so the reporter was fairly impressed. I mean, this is like 11th grade math. And so she sits down next to the girl, and she says, do you think this is fifth grade math? And the girl got a very mischievous grin on her face, and she goes, no, I think it's sixth grade. So she's in for a pleasant surprise, I think. So it's all well and good. Anecdotal data was good. The teachers were excited. Some of the kids didn't want to go to recess anymore. Math class became fun. Kids were taking ownership of their own learning. But we were all curious about what would the data actually say. And we were a little nervous because we were literally out the gate. We were a small organization. We're like, don't judge us too harshly. The product is improving every day. We're using the data to make it better and better. But everyone was curious about, well, what would happen? How will these kids perform on the state test? Because we're not teaching to the test. We're not even teaching the same thing. Some kids are doing algebra. Some kids are doing fourth grade math in the same classroom. And so this next chart right over here actually shows some of the data. And it's interesting, the fifth graders, 96% of them were at grade level or above, but that's actually not that different than Los Altos district-wide, which was like 92%. And frankly, those fifth graders didn't get to show off on the fifth grade assessment that some of them did know algebra or trigonometry or geometry or pre-algebra or whatever else. But what's exciting is this data right here, which the fifth grade was just standard Los Altos fifth grade class, high-performing demographic. The seventh grade classes were not your traditional Los Altos demographic. These were kids essentially from the other side of El Camino. And a lot of these kids were diagnosed with learning disabilities. They were from households where the parents never went to college. This was a remedial math class. And this was one we were worried about, but it actually showed the most exciting data. It wasn't a rigorous study. We're actually running those this year. But it was strong enough of a signal that the district wanted to do something more. And so that top chart shows the distribution of students entering into that class. So 23% were proficient. None of them were advanced, and even the proficient ones were at the bottom end of proficient. 47% basic, 23% below basic. So a very, this is why they were in a remedial math class. After 6 months, so we doubled the number. So 6 plus 35, 41% were now proficient. The whole distribution moved in the right direction. There were no more any kids far below basic. And this was the thing that was unheard of. This was a strong signal. Now there was a handful of kids in that class that were now advanced. There were a handful of kids that were diagnosed with learning disabilities, a handful of kids that were remedial math students that had now leapfrogged ahead of students in the traditional Los Altos classrooms. And these are traditional kids whose parents are engineers and Stanford professors and work at Google and all the rest. They leapfrogged ahead of those kids. These kids are in this remedial math class. And that was really the signal that that convinced them. Now, this last video I want to show you is a video that we got from a gentleman this last summer. And to us, you know, we're doing all this stuff with schools, but still the bulk of our, you know, the close to 5 million users are out there on the internet. Random people who are just hungry for knowledge, they're motivated by whatever factor, and they just need something to tap into their potential. And that's what this video is about.
My name is Mark Halberstadt. Growing up, I was really always a C student. I think I was really pretty much always pretty pitiful in school. I don't think I've ever gotten higher than a B plus in any math class ever, particularly. I pretty much thought that the only thing I was good enough to do in college was major in music. And I went off and I got a music degree in saxophone and had a great time doing it. I really enjoyed it a lot. But I sort of almost felt that it was more I was getting it because I was terrible at everything else. Kind of worked as a saxophone player for a few years, but sort of knew that I really, you know, wanted to do more, I guess. I knew that I really wanted to, really what I wanted to do was do electrical engineering, do more hands-on with math and science types of things. The last thing that I remember seeing in my mathematical career in high school was the last thing that I remember completely not getting was trig identities. So I went to YouTube and I did a search for trig identities, and the Khan Academy was the first thing that popped up. Watched a bunch of videos in the trig playlist to kind of get caught up to speed. I watched all the videos in the calculus playlist. I watched all the videos in the physics playlist. Watched a bunch of videos on dividing decimals and even on subtraction by borrowing. I watched a lot of videos on arithmetic. And anyway, that was in 2007. I did that until the fall of 2010. And in the fall 2010, I took a leap and I decided to go back to school and get into a degree program. And I went to Temple University, majored in electrical engineering, getting a second bachelor's. And I guess I'm making this because I just finished my first full year at Temple. I got perfect scores on both of my calc final exams and also on my chemistry final exam. I ended calculus, chemistry, both calculus classes, calc 1 and 2, and chemistry with an average higher than 100%. There are some Khan Academy videos that I probably listen to the same concept over 20 or 30 times. And there is no tutor in the world I could have paid to have sat next to me and repeated the same thing over 20 or 30 times without at least them getting a little bit judgmental, or at least them thinking like, oh, well, this guy really is never going to get this concept and he should just give up. Where the understanding really happened was watching those videos and also working through the Khan Academy software and everything. The impact for me in my life, I really see it growing exponentially over the next 20 or 30 years. So from the bottom of my heart, thank you.
Yeah, no, that's... So, you know, now here we are, Khan Academy, reaching all these people, and I think the interesting question is just, you know, where is all of this going? And, you know, our hope, and it was a kind of I kind of dreamt of this a few years ago, but now it seems a lot less delusional than it did then, is that we really think that we are at an inflection point in history, and every inflection point in history requires kind of new forms of institutions, and they often take advantage of the inflection point. And, you know, colonization of North America, Harvard, Yale, you have the Industrial Revolution, you have MIT, Stanford, the state universities, and we're at a bigger inflection point than any of those. And so we are hoping Khan Academy becomes this institution for this world, for the world, an institution that can genuinely educate children around the world for free. If they have nothing else, we think it's best paired with a physical experience, but if they have nothing else, at least they'll have access to it. A kid in rural Africa or rural India could have access to this. And even better, we're going to have data on it. We're going to be able to see where that talent emerges. We're going to be able to nurture it and foster it. So we look forward to going on this adventure with you, and I hope you use it with your kids at home. Thank you.